You know, today is actually the fulfillment of feast fruits. First fruits, the feast of first fruits. The world celebrates Easter, which is actually paganism.
Right.
They have no idea what's really going on in their rituals today. But today is actually the feast of first fruits. Everything is associated and revolves around the feast of the Lord. And if you don't know the feast of the Lord, you really don't understand the arena of who God truly is. It's very difficult. Because there's two things that revolve: the tabernacle of God and the feast of the Lord. Everything revolves around those two things. Everything. And in this, it's important to know the feast of the Lord, because when you celebrate these feasts, there's blessings. When you acknowledge them, there's blessings in them. You know, many people celebrate Christmas. And don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with honoring Christ's birth. Amen. His resurrection and his death. There's nothing wrong with it. In fact, we should be honoring that every single day. Amen. Just because a feast was fulfilled doesn't mean you stop.
Amen.
Amen. So we honor his resurrection, his birth, and his death every single day of our life, and the price that he paid for me and you.
Amen.
So even though it's a specific day, the specific day is associated with visitations and events.
Amen.
We know that only Jesus could fulfill the feast. So we know he's already fulfilled the first four feasts. Amen?
Amen.
The next feast is the Feast of Trumpets, which is the rapture of the church. And if we're not ready, you're left behind.
Amen.
Even if you proclaim to be a Christian, if you're not ready, you're left behind. Because remember, who you serve when you die is where you are. Jesus didn't just let anybody in. He paid the price for people to come in, amen?
Yeah.
But he said something very important. He said, follow me. Follow me. The famous words he showed to the disciples, he didn't even say, believe me. When he showed the disciples, he said, follow me.
Amen.
And they believed him. And they followed him. See, so when you truly believe, you follow. And God looks at each and every one of us in the areas where, if he says he believes me, then he should be following me. So when we say we believe but don't follow, God says, you lie.
Amen.
See, this is not an emotional relationship. It's a reality of truth.
Yeah.
Amen? The Bible says we walk by faith. Faith is actually spiritual sight. Because when God speaks, you see it and you do it. Amen? That's why faith comes by what?
Hearing.
What does it bring? Vision. Amen. And in these last days, there's something that the Lord is, I really believe that God is preparing. In fact, while we were praising and worshiping, I had a vision. And in this vision, I saw boats. I saw this boat. I saw people in the water. And there was boats cruising. And in the boat, people were waiting to be rescued. And some of them were in position to grab hold. Some of them were trying to, kept missing. They couldn't grab hold. And they'd have to wait for another boat to come. And they didn't know when that boat would come again. And when another boat came, some died before it got there. And some barely held on. Let me tell you, you don't want to miss the first boat.
Amen.
Because that's dangerous and disastrous. In 2 Peter chapter 1.
Oh, Lord.
Remember, this is not a religious arena. This is a military operation sent by the King of Glory, known as the Lord of Hosts, who's known as the Lord of Army. Amen? He's the Lord of the Armies. God sent me and you to this realm to fulfill a military operation and fulfill our mission. In 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 2, would you read it with me? Grace and peace be what? Multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of our Lord Jesus. As his what? Divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, to the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. In other words, he has given us divine power. What God is requiring, and he's sharing with us today, we've got to be in that place of maintaining the divine life. So we got it. This is a divine life. What is the divine life? The divine life always starts with being connected to God. When there's a disconnect, it's impossible to maintain the divine life. Why? Because then there's no power. In other words, if I unplug that fan from the wall, it stops running. It's the same thing when we unplug from God.
Amen.
Everybody okay?
Yeah.
Verse 5. But also, for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge self-control. To self-control, perseverance, to perseverance, godliness. To godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness.
Yep.
And has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your calling and call election indeed. For if you do these things, you will never what? You won't stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Again, I truly believe that the Lord is releasing, he's saying, look at, you must maintain your divine life. Amen? It is connected. It always starts with the connection from God by his Spirit. So his Spirit not only lives within us, but we have fellowship with the Spirit. Why? So you and I can partake of the divine nature. And we get divine power, which allows me and you to overcome the world of lust and deception that promotes sin and separation from God. Amen? That promotes what? Sin and separation from God. So we've got to stay connected. It's impossible to overcome. The Bible specifically says, submit to God and then what? Resist the devil. So if you're not submitting to God, it's impossible to resist the powers of darkness. It's impossible. And somebody gets it. In Acts 17, maintaining the divine life. Verse 29. Are we there? Therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone or something shaped by art or man's devising. Truly, these times of ignorance God has overlooked. But now what? Commands all men everywhere to what? Repent. Because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he had ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by what? Raising him from the dead. While fulfilling first fruits. Fulfilling the feast of first fruits. Raising him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked while others said, we will hear you again on this merry way. Again, this divine nature is offsprings of God by his resurrection from the dead. So the way that you maintain this new divine life, of course, is living in the resurrection, which means living in Christ, which is the resurrection power. Why? It's the power that overcomes everything. That's why it's vitally important to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. It's the second chamber of the tabernacle. Amen? That's why so many people go back and slide, backslide, in and out, because they're still living in the outer court. And we're going to be living in the holy place.
Yeah.
And the most holy place, not the outer court.
Right.
The outer court is a temporary place. Amen?
Yeah.
Revelation chapter 20. You know, sometimes people are going back and forth, They're going, God, why? Why? And the Lord says, because you're not maintaining power. Why are you not maintaining? Because you live in the outer court. You maintain power by living in the holy place. And there's something that's required, priesthood, which means you must minister to the Lord, because praise and worship brings the divine presence.
Amen.
Amen. Revelation 20. Again, this is not a religious act. This is not a religious Bible. It's the manual. Training for reigning. Amen. We're having training sessions.
Amen.
Revelation 20 and verse 1. Is everybody there?
Yes.
We're going to speak this together, please. It says, then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit, and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil, and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. He cast him into the bottomless pit, shut him up, and set a seal on him, so that he should deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years were finished. But after these 1,000 years, he must be released for a little while. And I saw thrones, and they that sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded. Is there beheading going on now? Yes. Well, then you know who Satan's foot soldiers are. Yes, they're Muslims, okay? Is everybody all right?
Yeah.
The ones that are beheaded out there, right?
Yeah.
And let me tell you, if you're a rid of Quran, it tells them to do that.
Yes,
so there may be moderate Muslims, and there may be other Muslims, and whatever. But the Quran says, murder, kill, lie, cheat.
Wow.
It's not God.
Yeah.
It's not the righteousness of Christ. That's the devil.
Yes,
sir. Well, thank you. That's right.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Now we go over. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 4,000 years. But the rest of the dead did not live again until 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Does everybody see that? Now look at this. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him for 1,000 years. Again, the first resurrection comes to the arena to where it's all the way through to the Feast of Atonement. Are you with me? It comes to the Feast of Atonement. Once the Feast of Atonement is done, that's the first resurrection. Then everybody will enter in the Feast of Tabernacles, which is a 1,000-year reign. And it's Zechariah chapter 14.
Hallelujah.
Zechariah verse chapter 14. And this is one that's going to happen in this fulfillment. Zechariah 14 and verse 1, it says, behold, the day of the Lord is coming, and your spoil will be divided in your midst. For I will gather all the nations to battle against Jerusalem. The city shall be taken, the houses rifled, and the women ravished. Half of the city shall go into captivity, but the remnant of the people shall not be cut off from the city. Then the Lord will go forth and fight against those nations as he fights in the day of battle. And in that day his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives. Let me share with you. The Lord will return, and we will return with him. And we will go to the Mount of Olives. And split in two and so forth, which faces Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall be split in two from east to west, making a very large valley. Half of the mountain shall move toward the north, and half toward the south. And you shall flee through my mountain valley, for the mountain valley shall reach us out. Yes. You shall flee as you fled from the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. Thus the Lord my God will come and all the saints with him. It shall come to pass in that day that there will be no light. The lights will diminish. It shall be one day, which is known to the Lord, neither day nor night, but at evening time shall happen, and it will be light. And in that day shall be that living water shall flow from Jerusalem, half of them toward the eastern sea and half towards the western sea. Both summer and winter it shall occur, and the Lord shall be king over all the earth, and that day shall be the Lord is one, and his name is one. In other words, the Lord returns to the Mount of Olives, fulfilling the Feast of Atonement, which will be associated with Armageddon. Why are we talking about this? Because it's a part of the resurrection. I'm sharing with you, this is the end of the first resurrection. Then we enter into the millennium in fulfillment of all those who made the first resurrection. Everybody okay? In Matthew 24. Why it's important to maintain a divine life, divine character, the divine nature. Why? Because that's who God sees. That's what he's looking for. And when he comes to get us, he's only taking those who live a divine life. Don't use the excuse, God knows your heart. Because he does.
Yeah.
But he judges by the fruit. Amen.
Amen.
If your food stinks, something's wrong. Yeah. You're in the wrong soil.
Okay.
Yeah. Matthew 24, verse 3. Now, as Jesus sat on the Mount of what? Olives. The disciples came to him privately, saying, tell us when these things will be, and what will be the sign of your coming, and at the end of the age. And Jesus answered and said to them, take ye that know him what? Deceive you. Why? Satan's greatest weapon is
deception.
For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and deceive many. I am a Christian, and deceive many.
Amen.
And you will hear wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines, pestilence, and earthquakes in various places. And all these will be the beginning of sorrows, which we know are associated with the breaking of the seals. And we're almost done with these. Then they will deliver you all to tribulation. Tribulation is the next event. Not only is tribulation the next event, but also the rapture is the next event. And they will kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many, and because of lawlessness will abound, and the love of many will what? Will cold. You know, there's more and more hatred now on this earth. You can sense the irritation all over. It's constant bombardment. There's more demonic activity on the earth. There's more. Remember, we've already entered the falling away. People are falling away. While people are falling away, many are getting saved. It says in verse 13 that what? He who endures to the end will be saved. He who endures to the end will be saved. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Remember, Jesus is living for Jesus.
Amen.
He's living for Jesus. Jesus in me and you. If we're allowing him to reign, he will be expressed. If we're denying him his way, he won't be expressed.
Yeah.
1 Corinthians 15. That means we don't approve of abortion. We don't approve of same-sex marriage. We don't approve of fornication, lying, cheating, stealing. We don't approve of the things that God doesn't approve of. Amen?
Amen.
No to approve of those things that God disapproves of will be judged right along with those.
Right.
In verse 12, please. 1 Corinthians 12. I'm telling you, we are entering a more and more, every day gets more and more critical in that area. We've got to become more and more serious in the area of our walk, our relationship. We can't allow the enemy to drift and begin to separate us. We cannot compromise. There are things that are happening behind closed doors that we don't even know about that are getting ready to manifest in him. In verse 12, would you read it with me? Now Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead. How do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there's no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes, we are found what? False witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he was raised up with Christ, whom he did not raise up. In fact, the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. If Christ is not risen, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. And also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiful. But now Christ has risen from the dead and has become the first fruits. Everyone say first fruits.
First fruits.
Of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, and by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. Again, know that in Christ means that you're living a divine life. Amen. It says, but each one in his own order, Christ, the first fruits. Afterward, those who are Christ at his coming. Then comes the end when he delivers the kingdom of God to the Father, God the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be destroyed is what? It is death. Praise God. Christ, the first fruits. Those that rose with him on the day that Jesus rose from the dead. Those that received him after that resurrection. Amen. And then those that accepted him during tribulation. Okay, look. So we have first fruits. The first is also associated with the first resurrection all the way through. First fruits. Now many of us have come to the Lord and become first fruits of our own families.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Don't know that the second death is after millennium. They will be raised. The second resurrection, I mean, will be after the millennium when people will be raised that have died. And they'll be judged. In June 15th. You know, I can only share that there are still many people out there playing. There's a saying called Russian roulette. They're playing that same game with God. Oh, hallelujah. In Jude, verse 15, verse 14, I'm sorry, would you read it with me? Now Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men also saying, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000 of the saints to execute judgment on all. Were they going to land? Not about us. However, they're going to get there. However, we're coming back as well. To convict all who are what? Ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have committed in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against them. These are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lusts. They mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how they told you in these And that there would be what?
Mockers
in the last time who would walk according to their own godly lusts. These are what?
Sensual
persons, who cause divisions, not having the Spirit, in other words, not maintaining the divine life. But you, beloved, building yourselves up in your most holy faith, praying in the tongues, praying in the Holy Spirit. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And on some have compassion, making a distinction, but on some of the others, save with what? Fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh. And now to him who's able to keep you from stumbling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To our God, Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever and ever and ever. But it takes something. There's a price that you and I must pay. What's it called?
Cooperation.
That's the price. Why? Because cooperation causes me and you to deny ourselves. When we deny ourselves in anything in this life, we are what we're doing, that was worth maintaining a life in the resurrection, which is a life in Christ, which is the divine life. Amen? In Matthew 27, maintaining the divine life. The only way to maintain a divine life is to maintain a divine connection. Amen? Matthew 27, verse 50. While Jesus was on the cross, he cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Verse 51. Behold the what? Behold the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth quaked and rocks were split. And the graves were what? Opened. And many of the bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. Now, again, I want to emphasize that these are the first fruits. Jesus, when he died, he went to hell. Amen. He was there for 3 days. Death, hell, and the grave, the authority away from Satan. Also give people who were in Hades an opportunity to follow him out. But you got to remember something, that Satan's kingdom deceives people, gives them false authority, thinking that they're somebody. Many followed Jesus out, but many didn't. He gave them an opportunity to come and follow him. He paid a price for all. And he died. He went to hell, even the center that was in hell. He did not go with the mock. Hurt. He did not go to mock. Oh, I told you I would come. That's not Jesus' character.
That's right.
Jesus' character is compassion and love. He came to rescue.
Amen.
He will come to judge the next time he comes. But in this first resurrection and his death, he came to rescue people from hell. And many who followed him were released. Now listen, so all of those that were the graves opened up at this time were all those who accepted Jesus Christ and followed him during Jesus' ministry. These were not patriarchs or anything of those. These were all those in the time of Jesus, at the time that he's been on the earth, that accepted him as Lord and Savior. These are the ones that the graves opened and their bodies were seen. And verse 53, and it says what? And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, and when Jesus rose and they came, here's the first fruits. Everybody got it? Now what happened to them? And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they what? They went into the holy city and appeared to many. Woo-hoo! See, because the first resurrection brings life. Amen? The second resurrection, there is no life. It's judgment. So here's the first fruits. And then there are the first fruits of those who received, amen, like you and I. And then there's also the first fruits that will accept during tribulations. These are all associated with first fruits of the first resurrection. And then when that is finished, at the Day of Atonement, well, then we enter The Feast of Tabernacles and dwell and reign for 1,000 years. Everybody okay?
Amen.
Praise God. Romans 8. Again, victory starts when we first deny ourselves. That's why Jesus did it this morning. Deny yourself, pick up the cross with a sword and follow him. In Romans chapter 8. Living in the resurrection constantly means living in the Spirit. So you and I must stay filled with the Spirit of God to maintain that anointing, Christ, the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty. Romans 8, that's why the Bible says, come out from among them, don't touch those things unclean, right? Romans 8, verse 18. Let's speak together. Romans 8, verse 18. For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. Who's that? Us. For the creation was subjected to fertility not only but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. That's us. Even all creation is going to be turned over to us. Why? Because we're going to be just like him. We'll have the same character. You won't be the way you are now. Hallelujah. You know, you know, those are those days you just can't stand yourself, amen?
Yeah.
Gosh. You just gotta take yourself and hang it in the closet. Amen. Those are the days you say, man, take me. How can you put up with this? I mean, that's how my conversations are. Did you see what I just did? I know you just thought, but I know you saw what I thought. I mean, but so many people have this this agenda or vision that think that they're in the gladiator times or when Caesar was running and the Christians were put in the areas, the auditoriums, and it's like, God's not like that. He's like, you know, somebody think God is. Get up!
Yeah.
Get up! Come on, get up! Move on, shake the dust and move. Let's go.
Amen.
Grab hold of my hand, I'll grab it. I didn't give you a kick in the butt now.
That's right.
That's my dad. Hallelujah. Verse 22. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pains and together until now. Not only that, but we also will have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. Thank you. That means you get eating Twinkies afterwards. You don't even want them. Praise God. James chapter 1. Let's get into the buying life. You won't wake up with aches and pains.
Hallelujah.
You won't have, Sometimer's disease.
Right?
Huh? Where's my keys? Where are they? I can't find them. Who was I just talking to? Oh, I hate that stuff. James chapter 1. verse 12. You know, when you start to age, you don't jump as high as you used to. You can't run as far as you used to. Now you take a bicycle. Then you go from bike to car. Then you finally get to a place where it's cab. I mean, you show up. I hope we all go home for it. Verse 12, James 1, verse 12. Let's speak it together. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he shall receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised those who love him. Let no one say, when he is tempted, I'm tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is what? Drawn away by his own desires. Man, let me share with you that these desires are always backed by an emotion. They're drawn away by emotion. How many of y'all know desire is an emotion? Right.
But I want to know how I feel.
No. You cannot allow feelings to dictate decisions. True. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's full grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good gift, every precious gift is from above, it comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. Of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. So then, my beloved brother, let every man be swift to hear, and slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. But be what? Be what? A doer of the word, and not a hearer's only, deceiving yourself. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is an idiot. He is like a man observing his natural face in the mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks in the perfect law of the liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer but a doer of the word, this one will be blessed in what he does. So we need to be doers, because we are the first fruits of resurrection. Amen?
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 5. Verse 16, let's speak it together. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, all things are of God, who has what? Reconciled us to himself, through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not imputing the trespasses to them, and has committed to you and me the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors of Christ, as though God were pleading through me and you. Amen. We implore you, as Christ, we have been reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sins for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. In where?
In
him. In Hebrews chapter 12. We are in Christ, old things pass away. But why doesn't it pass away with some people? Because they're not maintaining.
Amen.
They're not maintaining. And what will happen is, if you don't maintain, the old will come and catch up. You'll start manifesting the fruits that you used to be from the old. Remember, Jesus is looking for Jesus. That means that you and I got to maintain the divine life. That means the word says something specific. Be holy. Brian, holy. be holy. Now, you and I can't be holy in our own selves, amen?
No.
We can only be holy if we're connected to the divine order, the divine people, divine power. In Hebrews 12, is everybody there? Verse 22. Paul 22. But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to the innumerable company of angels. The general assembly, the church of the firstborn, who are registered in heaven, to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than Abel. See that you do not refuse him who speaks. For if they did not escape who refused him who spoke on earth, how much shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven? Whose voice then shook the earth, but now he has promised, saying, yet once more I shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. Now this, yet once more, indicates the removal of those things that are being shaken as of things that are made, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a what? Consuming fire. Everyone say, I'm a race.
I'm a race.
Designed.
Designed
for heaven.
For heaven.
That's who we are.
Amen.
We're not designed for this earth no more. You will never feel comfortable on this earth again. When you are born into the Spirit, you are never comfortable.
Right.
There's never anything that can fulfill.
Right.
Nothing. You can have all the money, and do all the drugs and whatever. Nothing will ever fulfill.
Amen.
Only God's presence.
Amen.
I don't care how educated you are. I don't care how dumb you are.
Right. Amen.
Praise God.
That's right.
You can never fulfill. That's how we get it.
Amen.
Thank God we have the wisdom of God. There should be no dummies in the kingdom.
Amen.
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 We are of a higher order.
Amen.
Not because of anything we did, but everything that he did.
Amen.
That's why he says, grab hold, cooperate, stay connected.
Hallelujah.
So we can walk in a divine life with divine wisdom. Amen. Because we are a race designed for heaven. You know, we're actually a test of citizenship for eternity. Philippians 3. Are you learning something?
Yes.
Are you getting it?
Yes.
Are you going to use it?
Yes.
Remember, Jesus is living for Jesus.
Yes.
If you're not producing the fruit of Jesus, you're going to miss the hook.
Amen.
You're going to miss the boat. Philippians 3:7, please. Speak it. For what things were gained to me, these I have counted lost for Christ. Have we reached that point yet?
Yes.
That's final decision.
Amen.
So everybody got it. That's final decision. Let me share something that in our labor, we labor unto the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
We labor unto the Lord. Why do I labor unto the Lord? Everything we do, we should be laboring unto the Lord. Do you know that even works is considering this worship if it's labored unto the Lord?
Amen.
For laboring unto the Lord. Yes, we need to have arms, and, but we're not building our arms, but we're building his.
Amen.
Amen. Labor not to the Lord. When we do that, he's honored by that.
Yep.
It's a form of worship to him. When we go to work and say, Lord, I'm here to labor for you. I labor not by to expand your kingdom. My purpose is, I know I need to maintain a life, but my purpose is to expand your kingdom. Because when there comes a point where I can't maintain, he will. So this verse right here, but what things were For gain to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. That makes me come to a final decision. There is no turning back.
Amen.
My life is in Christ. That's it. I'm done, over with. I'm ready to renounce the Lord. I will serve until I give my last breath.
Yes.
And the next time I see him, we'll do a high five. Verse 8. Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as what?
Rubbish,
that I may gain Christ. And there isn't anything greater when God begins to restore it.
Yeah.
It's when we have to do it and maintain it that we struggle and get frustrated.
Yeah.
And be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may what?
Know
him. In the power of his resurrection, everyone say, know him.
Know him.
In the power of his resurrection.
That
I may maintain. Find what? That I may know him. In the power of his resurrection. That I may know him. In the fellowship of his what?
Sufferings.
So when you go through trials and tribulations, which is your sufferings, you can always compare that with Jesus. Being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Conforming to his death is victory. Remember, victory begins by denying yourself. Amen?
Amen.
Denying ourselves. Colossians 3, verse 1. Let's read it. And then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above. Seek those things which are above. Where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things above, not on the things of the earth.
Amen.
So when you wake up every morning, you acknowledge home.
Amen.
Why? That's, you're a citizen of eternity now. You connect to maintain a divine life here. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God.
Amen.
Aren't you glad you're dead?
Yes.
Okay, now let me tell you about dead people. They never grumble. They never complain.
They don't get offended.
They don't get offended.
Amen.
They don't accuse.
Yay.
Number one.
They don't betray. Okay.
When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Now, when Christ, who is our life, appears. Therefore, verse 5, put to death your members, which are on the earth. What's the first one? Fornication, uncleanness, passion. Evil desires, covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you yourselves are to put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, who is renewed in the knowledge according to the image of him who created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave nor free, but Christ is all and what? And in all. Now I'm going to close at Galatians 5. Maintaining the divine life, living in the resurrection, which is also living in Christ. Starts by victoriously, by denying yourself. See, you can't even get connected without first denying yourself.
Amen.
That's right.
I need to connect. You need to deny yourself.
Amen.
I need to connect. Well, then do it. So simple. Call on him, acknowledge him. He's waiting every morning when you and I get up in the morning. Every morning. He's waiting. Hello, good morning. Verse 16. I say then, what? Walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so you do not do the things that you wish or desire. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not in the law, you are called sons of God, because if you are led by the Spirit, you are maintaining the divine law.
Amen.
Amen. Now the works of the flesh are what? Which are what? Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and anything like it, which I told you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things are not expressing Jesus. So that means they cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Everybody got it? Okay, keep your finger in Romans 8. Romans 8, 1. Keep your finger here. We'll be right back. Stay tuned. Romans 8, verse 1. What does it say? There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Hello. So there are those who say, I'm a Christian, but I'm not walking in divine life. Because he says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. But he says, look, you get disqualified if you're walking in the flesh. For what the law cannot do, that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So it can only be fulfilled if you're walking according to the Spirit. Does everybody get it? So we just saw here what the works of the flesh is not expressing Jesus. Those are not Jesus' character. Amen.
Amen.
So anything of the flesh is anti-Christ. Anything of the Spirit of God is Christ. So anything, even the Bible says that it's sin to not even to not walk in faith. Anything that you and I do, should be done by faith, right? Because we hear and we see, we hear and we see, we hear and we see, we hear and we see. We are in?
Amen.
All right, let's finish. Let's go. All right, so it says then, but verse 22, but the what? The fruit of the Spirit is what?
Love,
joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. So these are what? Christ. These are divine nature. This is the character of Christ.
Amen.
This is divine life. That means when Jesus comes, he sees Jesus. And those who are in Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. And don't become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another, because you'll go right back into the flesh. Of God before us, we'll be against us. See, all happened. Remember, we are tested citizens. We are a race designed for eternity. So don't let the mirror dictate who you are. Amen. Don't let your circumstance dictate who you are. Everybody makes mistakes. Get up, shake the dust off.
Amen.
And go.
Amen.
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 And what you know you're doing wrong, stop.
That's right.
Ask for divine power. Don't let your thoughts dictate your decisions. Because the voice of the stream comes in multiple ways. Amen. Let's live that life. Maintain a divine life so that Jesus sees Jesus in you. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. We ask for your forgiveness, Lord. We have dethroned Jesus in us. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, Spirit of the living God, in the name of Jesus, to take your rightful place in the throne of our heart, our mind, our will, our desires, and our life, that we may walk and maintain the divine life where Christ can be seen and be glorified. In Jesus' name. Everybody say amen.